पांडे सर आप हैं? नमस्कार, ऑनरेबल टुडे गेस्ट स्पीकर डॉक्टर सुनील पांडे सर, डायरेक्टर एनवायरनमेंट एंड वेस्ट मैनेजमेंट डिवीजन टेरी, रिस्पेक्टेड अवर डायरेक्टर सीएसआर सिम्फर डॉक्टर पीके सिंह सर, माय डियर कलीग्स फ्रॉम हेड ऑफिस धनबाद एंड फ्रॉम डिफरेंट रीजनल रिसर्च सेंटर्स एट बिलासपुर, नागपुर, रांची, रुड़की एंड रानीगंज, अ वेरी गुड आफ्टरनून टू एवरीबडी। नाउ आई रिक्वेस्ट माय डायरेक्टर डॉक्टर पीके सिंह टू प्लीज वेलकम अवर गेस्ट सर।
नमस्कार डॉक्टर श्रीपाल, धन्यवाद। तो फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल दिस इज अ वेरी गुड अपॉर्चुनिटी फॉर अस टू लिसन द लुमिनरीज हु इज वर्किंग इन द एनवायरनमेंट एंड बेस्ट मैनेजमेंट। दिस इज अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट टॉपिक एंड आई एम वेरी हैप्पी दैट डॉक्टर पांडे, श्री सुनील पांडे हैज काइंडली कंसेंटेड टू बी आवर स्पीकर ऑन आवर प्लेटिनम जुबली सेलिब्रेशंस। It is very, I wanted to emphasize you, sir, that Simpher is celebrating its 75th year, and Bharat Ka Amrit Mahotsav is also running side by side. So on these two both auspicious occasion, you are our guest speaker, and I am very much confident with your vast knowledge in theory, my scientists, technical staffs, and other colleagues will get benefited from your talk. And with these words, I once again welcome you, sir. And whenever you have a time, I request you to physically visit Simpher Dhanbad so you can guide our researchers, young scientists, and motivate them to do quality science. With these words, welcome to you and over to Dr. Sripal.
Thank you very much, sir. I would like to share a few information about our institute. As a portion of the audience is from outside the Simpher, so just a brief, I would like to say about CSR, Central Institute of Mining and Fuel Research, is a constituent laboratory under the aegis of Council of Scientific and Industrial Research, New Delhi. It provides R&D inputs for the entire coal energy chain, encompassing exploration, mining, and utilization. The institute was one of the first amongst various groups of laboratories set up in India. The foundation stone of the institute was laid on 17th November 1946 by then Minister of Bharat Mines and Power of Interim National Government, Sri C.H. Bhavsar. It has glorious 75 years journey in R&D works on coal exploration, coal mining to coal utilization. We are celebrating the glorious 75 years in befitting manner. During the Platinum Jubilee year, we are organizing a lecture series from eminent speakers from all over the globe. Today, CSR Simpher Bilaspur Research Center is organizing a lecture from a very eminent speaker, Dr. Sunil Pandey, sir. Dr. Sunil Pandey is the Director, Environment and Waste Management Division, TERI. In addition, he is adjunct faculty at the TERI School of Advanced Studies. He has more than 25 years of consultancy research experience in the areas of municipal, industrial, and hospital waste management, plastic waste management, waste-to-energy issues, impact assessment, air, water, and soil quality monitoring, site assessments, performance evaluation of ETP, and institutional strengthening and capacity building. He has obtained his PhD degree in hazardous waste characterization from Nagpur University while working as a project fellow at NIRI Nagpur. He has done MSc in analytical chemistry from Banaras Hindu University, India, and did his BSc chemistry from the same university. Prior to joining TERI, Dr. Sunil Pandey has worked for ERM India as consultant for 2 years, where he was working on projects related to hazardous and hospital waste management, environmental site assessment, and institutional strengthening and capacity building. Dr. Sunil Pandey has also worked as research assistant at Hong Kong University of Science and Technology on development of landfill liner for containment of land disposed hazardous waste, and University of Hong Kong on deriving material balances and associated environmental pollution for Hong Kong region as part of postdoctoral research work. Dr. Sunil Pandey has a vast experience, and his biodata is very, very big. So just I'm just stopping much about, can I say, Dr. Sunil Pandey here, because everybody is interested to hear him. So please, sir, up to the chief guest.
Thank you very much, and also I would like to thank Dr. Singh for inviting me here, and also congratulate all CMFRI fraternity for observing 75th Platinum Jubilee year. And with that, I'll start my presentation. What I'll do is I'll keep my video off so that in case if there's a bandwidth problem, it won't affect the presentation slides. Just see. Aap log presentation dekh pa rahe honge mera abhi? I'll put it on full screen. My presentation is visible to all of you?
Yes, sir. We are getting, sir.
Oh, okay. Good, good. So my, what I'm going to talk about today is hamara jo waste to energy projects hain, which are very popular, which have been discussed from very long time in the country, and there are various projects which have worked very successfully in the country, but there are projects which have not shown that much success. So we'll discuss why, I mean, these projects which are not very successful. When you talk to, especially when you're looking at waste energy projects with reference to municipal solid waste, what are the challenges and what are barriers, and what kind of projects are more successful and what kind of projects are not so successful in the country. So with that background, I'll start my presentation. So very briefly, if you look at content of the presentation, it will cover very one or two slides on overall scenario for municipal solid waste management, need for why we should be looking at waste to energy options. We'll not talk so much on international status, but on a case study which we did based on work which was done by international agencies in India. Technology options, what technology options we are looking at when we look at waste to energy options. Some of the barriers for implementing waste to energy projects, if, especially if you look at municipal solid waste based projects. And then I'll end up my presentations with conclusions and followed by discussions on question and answers from the participants. So if you look at hum log waste to energy kaise define karte hain, simple definition, if you go for a very simple definition, capturing energy from processing of waste, either in form of electricity or in form of heat, thermal also, is waste to, is something which we call waste to energy. CPCB has carried out MSW, Municipal Solid Waste Characterization, across various Indian cities when they were looking at, though this data is around 10 years old now, but this is most kind of comprehensive data set for the waste characterization which was carried out across different cities in the same year. So if you look at the important learnings from this waste characterization data, compostable part of the waste, which is easily degradable and mostly comprising of food waste, green waste, which we call in municipal solid waste, ranges from 30 to 55%, but mostly on an average, if you look at average, it will be around 40 to 50% of this will be compostable, whatever is generated in cities. Recyclable waste, comprising of paper, plastic, metal, glass, ranging from 5 to 15%. And this plastic is something which is most produced. Plastic packaging, if you see, on an average, it is around 8 to 10% pan-India. Recently, last year also, Central Pollution Control Board did a study with an organization which is working on plastics, which is called CIPET. Their estimate was 8 to 10% on an average is plastic waste generation on this. Inerts, basically the sweeping, the cleaning, the dust, concrete, etc. And construction and demolition debris. CND stands for construction and demolition waste, ranges from 40 to 55%. Then in the chemical characteristics, they also looked at carbon to nitrogen ratio, and which was ranging from 14 to 53, which is important because if you look at, if you want to process your waste, say through composting, and if you want to make compost, then carbon to nitrogen ratio of above 20-25 ensures that there's good nitrogen content in the compost which you produce. Moisture, generally, I mean, for very dry cities in Western India, 17, but on an average, 17 to 65% in very rainy cities. But on an average, you can assume that 50% of your waste will be moisture. So overall, 50% around would be green waste in your MSW. And in that green waste, it will be mostly moisture because it's a green waste. Calorific value, which is energy content, very important for waste to energy projects if they have to be viable in the country, ranges from 520 to 3766 kilocalories per kg. But important thing to notice here is on average, if you look at most of the cities, barring few very industrial cities, the calorific value ranges from on an average is from 800 to 1200 kilocalories per kg. That indicates that the waste which we generate, if you call municipal solid waste generated from cities, they are low in calorific value and high in moisture content. And that is why your waste to energy technology has to be such technology which can address these two aspects of high moisture content, high green waste, and low calorific value. Key features, if you look at on how municipal solid waste is managed in most of the cities. Recyclables, which is paper, plastic, glass, wagera ki baat karte hain. This is collected by waste pickers. Aur hamare ghar mein bhi kabaddi wale time to time aate hain, aap sab ke ghar mein aate honge. Aur wo seedhe wahan se collect karke jaate hain. Wo aapko dispose karne ki zarurat nahi padti hai. And that is sent directly for recycling. Abhi last to last year, ek AIKMA karke organization hai, All India Institute of Plastic, All India Association for Plastic Manufacturers. Unka report jo aaya hai, uske hisab se hum 70% waste recycle kar rahe hain, which is good news. But problem kaha aata hai ki jo jyada tar recycling hamara ho raha hai, wo informal sector mein ho raha hai. And that is a problem because of not very good technology being used, and because of kind of informal recycling, which doesn't bring very high revenue from the recycling. Construction and demolition debris, jyadatar cities mein abhi to land pe dispose ho raha hai. Kuch cities ne 2016 mein jab waste management rules aaye the, to kuch cities ne abhi apne yahan construction and demolition debris recycling plants lagaye hain. Delhi mein hai, Rajkot mein hai, Ahmedabad mein hai, aur baki cities jo hai abhi commission karne ke process mein hai. But ye construction and demolition debris mein jyadatar waste jo malba jisko hum bolte hain, ज्यादातर वेस्ट जो है रिसाइकल हो सकता है और ज्यादातर सिटीज में रूल्स के हिसाब से अब रिसाइकलिंग प्लांट लगाना है. तो जैसा मैंने पहले बोला, हाई मॉइस्चर कंटेंट एंड लो कैलोरीफिक वैल्यू ऑफ ऑर्गेनिक फ्रैक्शन ऑफ म्युनिसिपल सॉलिड वेस्ट मेक्स इट मोर अमेनेबल टू बायोकेमिकल कन्वर्जन, नॉट टू द कन्वेंशनल क्लासिकल थर्मल बेस्ड वेस्ट एनर्जी प्रोजेक्ट. एंड दैट इज द रीजन हमारे यहाँ पे जो भी वेस्ट एनर्जी प्लांट्स आते हैं, अगर थर्मल रूट पे बेस्ड ऑन burning the waste, if they come on that basis, then a lot of time they fail. Because if we are not segregating waste, then the poor quality of waste goes into burning and producing energy. Issues, ye slide mein main aapko waste to energy projects, waste ka kya status abhi, and why we need the waste to energy projects, wo discuss karunga. Municipal solid waste, which was reported at 7 million tons per annum, in 1947, अभी जो है प्रेजेंट सीपीसीबी के एस्टिमेट्स के हिसाब से वी आर जनरेटिंग अराउंड 62 मिलियन टन पर एनम. ऑफ दैट 50% इज ऑर्गेनिक. इंडस्ट्रियल हैजर्डस वेस्ट जो कि इस प्रेजेंटेशन में हम लोग बात नहीं करेंगे बट वो भी एक इंपॉर्टेंट एस्पेक्ट है. इंडस्ट्री से जनरेट हो रहा है. दिस इज जनरेटेड अराउंड 7.23 मिलियन टन पर एनम. इसका 30% जो है इज ऑर्गेनिक वेस्ट. एंड इंपॉर्टेंटली सिंस यू ऑल आर फ्रॉम माइनिंग बैकग्राउंड द माइनिंग वेस्ट मोस्ट ऑफ द माइनिंग वेस्ट इज नॉट इंक्लूडेड इन हैजर्डस वेस्ट. इंडस्ट्रियल हैजर्डस वेस्ट माइनिंग वेस्ट बिकम्स नॉन हैजर्डस इंडस्ट्रियल वेस्ट बट वेदर इट इज बैकफिलिंग और overburden or mine tailings but because of the low hazard which it presents so it is not counted in 7.23 million tons per annum. And this waste the agencies who also estimated that if all of this waste is not processed, not recycled, then this would require 1750 acres of land if they have to be disposed on land, which is a huge requirement of land. And most of the cities, as they are growing, as fast as they're growing, have a lot of problem in identifying land. And that is why it is required that we process more and more waste and send less and less for disposal. Waste energy recycling is important because we are short on resources. But waste energy is also important because the power demand is growing. If you look at the recent forecast, though under lockdown, the demand for power went down for a while, but now it has all again picked up, and power demand in the country is pegged around 8 to 8.5% for financial year 2020. And most of this power actually comes at present from coal-based power plants. But there's now a lot of pressure. Aap log jo climate discourses mein abhi COP mein jo chal raha hai, if you are following that, you realize that in India, if we have to take G20 leadership on climate negotiation, then we'll have to make commitment that we'll shut down a lot of our coal power plants, because coal power plants are one of the key contributors to climate change issue. So that is why we need to look at alternate energy sources. Solar, we are already going very aggressive. Wind, we have developed some, but there's a limitation on wind. Thermal, hydro, also what size of thermal hydropower plants can be built safely is again issue of debate. So one important aspect here becomes a waste to energy, because waste is something which we generate every day, and waste has to be managed every day. So if we can use some amount of the 62 million tons per annum, if you look at what I say is 30 million tons of this would be organic waste. And this has potential to produce power. And also important because most of the cities, they face peak hour power shortages because of tremendous increase in refrigeration and cooling needs in the cities. Also because of transmission and distribution losses. Another very important factor, there's an indifferent supply situation of fossil fuels. You know that fossil fuel prices, crude prices have gone up. It was low some 2 years back, but now it has again gone up. And retail prices of fossil fuel has gone up a lot in the country. And obviously in India, we have limited crude resources. And globally also, wherever there are crude resources, they also will run out very soon if everyone keeps consuming like that. If you look at municipal solid waste, what are challenges? Specifically, looking at when you look at municipal solid waste, there are certain challenges which are different than industrial hazardous waste. Waste composition changes. We are not generating same type of waste every day because our eating habits, our purchasing habits, our consumption habits are not same every day. So waste composition keeps changing on a daily basis, weekly basis. And of late, what we have seen is because of a lot of e-commerce happening, a lot of other economic developing, there's an increasing quantity of packaging waste. packaging waste, which was much less earlier. Now it is going up and up. Good news is that as packaging waste will go up, the food waste will go down, because there'll be better and better processing of food, better and better packaging of food. But still, on an average, at this point of time, we would continue generating 40 to 50% of organic waste in the waste stream. If you look at second bullet point, general apathy of local bodies. Local bodies, the municipal corporations, municipalities, they don't want to spend a lot of money on waste management. Or public, residents have city, they also don't, they are not too much bothered about waste management. Because usse unko directly effect nahi hota, except for certain seasons when suddenly waste management becomes a problem. Otherwise, air pollution se unko direct interest hai. Water pollution mein paani pi ke log bimar ho jate hai, so they are more concerned. But MSW se abhi utna concern nahi hota hai. So this problem, jaisa maine pehle bataya, as this can be addressed by adopting waste energy technologies. Purpose is to maximize processing of waste and minimize waste which is going to landfill for disposal. This is also in compliance with municipal solid waste rules. Joki rules, first time country mein 2000 mein. Obviously, I mean, it has been amended in 2016. But if you look at even at the in the municipal waste rules 2000, it clearly said that waste segregation is required and waste processing is required. And final disposal to the landfill site should be minimized so that there is less and less requirement for disposal sites. MSW ko agar hum waste energy route pe jana chahe aur waste energy ke process se jo hai power produce karna chahe, to isme kuch challenges hain specific to waste energy projects. Challenges kya hain? Jaisa maine pehle bola, variability in composition. Unlike industrial waste in industry comes from the same process most of the time. So the composition doesn't change so much. A very minor composition changes would be there. Municipal solid waste, on the other hand, always changes the composition. And you need a homogeneous composition for feeding, if you are going for waste energy, for feeding the waste into combustion chamber or feeding the waste to the reaction digesters, you need some homogeneity in composition. So that's one challenge. Higher moisture content in the waste, because if you feed high moisture content waste for energy recovery, then a lot of energy goes into drying the waste first and then recovering energy from that. This moisture content, and also if inerts are high, they can at sometimes cause fouling of the equipment, because equipments are all they can cause corrosion if they are not handled properly, and they can cause fouling of the equipment. And if the inerts are high, then they can also cause abrasion in the equipment. So the overall life of the equipment goes down. Use of unsegregated waste. If we don't segregate our waste properly, and if there are toxic constituents in the waste, that can lead to emission of toxic heavy metals also in combustion to produce energy from the waste energy technologies. So there is a need certainly for improving our present waste management practices to look at segregation, waste collection, segregated transport of waste, and pre-processing of waste to make it amenable for waste energy projects. If you see our policy documents, so the old policy documents after the advent of solid waste management rules, NEP is National Environment Policy, and NEPCC is a National Action Plan on Climate Change. NEP came in 2006 and National Action Plan came in 2008. They also emphasize that there's a need to develop waste to energy projects in India. And also there's a need for indigenous development of such projects and customization of waste to energy technologies so that they can work in Indian conditions. Agar waste to energy projects hum dekhte hain, to their various options which work in different countries with varying degree of success. Incineration is most popular in the country where they have shortage of land. For example, countries like Korea, Japan, Singapore, Hong Kong, where there is not much land available for land disposal. There mostly they prefer incineration based treatment option, where everything with little pre-processing. They send it to incineration for burning the waste and also energy recovery. Landfilling with gas recovery is also one option which a lot of bigger countries, they do. Countries like USA, countries like China, where there is a lot of land available and waste is put into land. And under anaerobic condition, when the methane gets generated, they use that gas for recovery of energy. I have a case study on this, which we did as a research project from support of MOFCC. I'll discuss that later. Then there's the option of waste, the combustible waste, waste like cloth, rag, paper, leather, footwear. Such things can be crushed and made into briquettes. These briquettes are called refuse-derived fuel. So they can be also used for power generation, like any other biomass-based briquettes or briquettes. Then there is anaerobic digestion process. When I said biochemical process, it's a biomethanation process. Then there were emerging technologies like pyrolysis and gasification and plasma arc pyrolysis, which are still facing problem in terms of commercialization. Sorry. So when we are looking at waste to energy projects, this was the assessment was done for Asian Development Bank and Department of Economic Affairs, India. We are looking at various project options and which of these would be suitable in India and which of it will not be suitable for India. Landfill with landfill gas extraction. Advantages, low cost energy recovery because gas is already coming out and you can use it for energy recovery. It can be controlled and high recovery, but provided your landfill site is properly scientific designed landfills. If they are open dumps, then cost can be higher. Disadvantage, uncontrolled gas, like if you have open dump, then gas can escape. It requires significant landfill infrastructure if it is open dump again, and requires high volume of waste and large land area. It is not recommended for India as the rules, they prohibit disposal of organic waste at the landfill. They say that organic waste has to be processed close to the source of generation. So no organic waste should be going for disposal site. Incineration, it is more suitable for high calorific value waste, like if waste is dominated by paper, wood, plastics. Relatively free from noise, odor, and requires less land area for commissioning, smaller land footprint. But unlike landfill, this is capital intensive. High capital cost and high operation and maintenance cost. Low heating value waste are not suited. If the calorific value is not high, then this is not this is not the technology. Toxic metals and chlorinated plastics, if they are burnt, then they also need lead to pollution. And as I said earlier, requires high UNM cost. This was also not recommended because if you don't have high calorific value waste, and on an average we generate 50% green waste with a lot of moisture. So that is why this is not recommended. Biomethanation, advantages can be small scale with no external power source required because the power which the project generates can run the project also. Totally closed and modular construction possible. So odor and visible pollution is reduced. Disadvantages, like it's not as costly as incinerators, but it is also costly. And requires high degree of easily biodegradable material. If it's a green waste, kitchen waste, food waste, then that is ideal for biomethanation. So that is why it is recommended only with segregated MSW, where you know that the only food waste or only canteen waste or only restaurant waste is going to the biomethanation plant. Using RDF, refuse derived fuel for burning. If you process your waste properly, then fuel produced has high energy content. And once it is processed into briquettes, then it is convenient to store and transport. But if waste has to be pre-processed and crushed, then you require high energy in crushing and drying of waste, if it has also significant amount of moisture. High inorganic content can reduce calorific value, so reduce the effectiveness of fuel. Recommended only if the waste is free from chlorinated chemicals, like incinerators only. Gasification and pyrolysis, they are kind of, again, thermal technologies, but they were not recommended because there's no, if you look at disadvantages, The second bullet says no commercial plant on MSW as yet. There are plants on specific feedstock, like, for example, waste tires or segregated plastics. But on MSW, still, we don't have any commercial plant working. So there's a need for sector. Waste to energy technologies need to be looked at in a more systematic manner. And out of this table, we would focus more on something which is now showing some potential, like integrated facilities, RDF facility-based facilities, and biomethanation facilities. So incineration, as I said earlier, this is kind of schematic on how overall process is followed. MSW, when it reaches the incineration plant, some amount of drying and segregation is done. Pelletization is optional. You can do pelletization. You can feed your waste without pelletization also in the flub form. For pelletization, if you go for pelletization, then you have to add some amount of fuel and binder to the project, to the process, to make it homogenized. And then it is fed to incineration. Sometimes supplementary fuel is required. Sometimes supplementary fuel is not required. And the end products are ash, heat, which can be used as it is. In many cold countries, heat is used as for district heating purposes. Otherwise, it can be converted into power. And flue gas, which are let into air with some cleaning. This we have already discussed. One interesting modification of incineration system is not typically classical waste to energy projects, but over the years, what we have also learned that the same waste which was going to incinerator plants can also go to the cement plants, because cement plants also use a lot of coal, and any fuel which is if the calorific value is in the range of 2500 to 2500 kilocalories and above can be very safely used as alternate fuel in the cement plants, replacing some amount of coal. In fact, CII has come out of with a report saying that 25% of fuel substitution can take place in most of the cement plants by replacing coal. Advantage, it supplements traditional fuel, and waste treatment is also cheap because the waste which is burnt as a fuel finally becomes part of the cement matrix as a residue, and there's no disposal required. Disadvantage, though, I mean, cement kilns can take care of some amount of chlorides because in cement, lime is also used as raw material. So lime can neutralize some amount of chlorides or some amount of sulfates. But if the chlorides are very high, then it is not acceptable because the product which comes out as a cement then does not set very easily. So that becomes a problem. And another problem is distance over which waste can be transported, because cement companies, they don't want to pay for the waste management. So if waste can be transported to their cement plants with no cost to cement kilns, then only they can be used by the cement plants. This is one project which was registered in UNFCCC when the CDM projects were alive, and this was for Trichy Municipal Corporation, how they process their waste and then supply it to the cement plant as an alternate fuel, and how with coal and pet coke, this was co-incinerated, co-burned to produce cement, and how they could get some CDM revenue out of this project in co-combustion of waste in cement kilns. Refuse derived fuel, simple flow sheet is more or less like incinerator plant only. The first step is again drying and segregation. Essential step here is pelletization to produce refuse derived fuel. And the way it is different from incinerators is generally most of the RDF based power plants, they have dedicated boilers where you can put your waste into boiler and produce steam and generate power by turbines. End product, waste product here also is ash and some fuel gas, flue gas, which has to be cleaned. This is typical MSW-based refuse derived fuel, when I say RDF, where waste is segregated, sorted, dried, and all the combustible fractions They are palletized and with suitable binders, of course, but they are palletized. And this is how they look like. And now you see, I mean, once the fuel is palletized, it's much easier to handle, much cleaner to handle. It is easily it can be easily bagged, packed, and also transported. So it's not necessary that this is used only for power production. If the calorific value is uniform, this can also go to industry for use in their furnaces and boilers. This is one example of one of the old RDF producing power plants, which was started by Ministry of New and Renewable Energy, MNES at that point of time, for supporting RDS in production of, supporting R&D in production of RDF. Key features we have already discussed. Next technology option, which we had recommended in when we were evaluating technologies, was biomethanation or anaerobic digestion. Typically, as you see in the photo, there's a closed reactor. So once waste can be segregated, degradable waste, easily degradable waste is segregated, it can be put into this biomethanation unit. It undergoes biodegradation and produces methane. And methane concentration can range around 40 to 50%. But now they are advanced biodigesters working on high rate degradation systems. They can produce methane in the range of 60-70, sometimes if the waste quality is good, 80% also. So that's a potential area where, I mean, a lot of potential direction where a lot of efforts is now being done on promoting biomethanation projects. Typical flow of for a city, if a city, typical city generates 500 tons per day waste, what can be done in that city if you're looking at waste to energy process? From the generators, whether it is households or restaurants or marketplace or institutional premise, hospitals, the municipal waste generators, the collection is through two routes. One is waste directly sent to Kabadiwalas. Second is it is given to D2Ds, door-to-door collection, to municipal authorities, or if there is an NGO working in area, in your area, he'll come and pick up the waste from your office, from your premises. And also some waste which is generated in commercial areas or city, or if some littering happens, then rag pickers pick up that waste and collect. Some amount of that waste goes to recycling. Balance, what can happen is it can go to waste processing. And I've given an example here. 250 tons can go to anaerobic digesters, producing around 1.25 megawatt power. At least minimum 1.2 megawatt of power can be produced. The recyclables can go for recycling, but things which cannot be recycled can go for refuse derived fuel. And in this, if you look at 500 tons per day, around 100 tons per day can be converted to RDA to produce 1 megawatt of power. And the residue of this waste processing only needs to go to the landfill. So that is why you can reduce the amount of waste to a large extent, which is due for destined for disposal. But if you are looking at large waste to energy projects, and sometimes, because in a lot of such cities, for example, in Delhi, there's a project which is around which is processing 2,000 tons per day. Then at such large scale, there's often problem of that if you're looking at large such projects, it has some impact on the social side, livelihood of rag pickers who are working in the cities to remove the recyclable waste. In most cities, 10 to 15% of waste is removed by rag pickers. Rag pickers essentially are large or an organized workforce. So if you kind of put up your own collection system, if the large projects puts their own collection system, then you affect the livelihood of rag pickers. One way it can be looked at is whatever rag pickers pick up, if they cannot sell it for recycling, whatever they can sell for recycling, that is fine. Something which is very dirty or of little value, they cannot send it for recycling. That waste energy plants can buy from them And that would make waste to energy projects more financially more attractive. And as the rule regulations require, RAC pickers also can be formally inducted by local bodies, NGOs, private operators for doorstep collection of waste, because the doorstep collection of waste is labor intensive, and that is where you require people who can manually collect the waste. So this will not only protect their livelihood, but also enhance their income. What I'll do is now, before I go to the case study, I'll discuss with you some of the barriers which are there typically for when you're looking at waste to energy project in Indian context. Technical barriers, there are two technical barriers like incineration, though it is well researched, but because of high capital cost and emissions, not so much use in India. And also what happens is waste, if waste is not segregated properly, then it becomes very expensive to process that in incineration system. Other processes like pyrolysis and gasification need more work, making the product available at the commercial level. Non-technical barriers, typically with the solid waste management system, unavailability of source segregation waste, though, I mean, if you are following SBM, Swachh Bharat Mission, you'll find that last year when they came out with their draft action plan, around 60% of households are now segregating waste. That's a good news. But eventually, this segregation has to go up to at least 80 to 90%, so that good quality of feedstock is available for waste processing. And also some value addition is required, pre-processing is required for segregated waste. High cost of energy generation, because I mean, if you don't segregate your waste normally, then the waste to energy plants will also have to install waste segregation system. So that adds to the cost of energy. And pollution control process, because if you're processing mixed waste, then you also need higher cost in pollution control process. And poor management record of operation in India. That is why most of the time when the waste to energy projects start, most of the time, except for 2-3 projects, after 2-3-4 years, they close. Another non-technical barriers, because of the poor record of the waste to energy operations in India, is lack of public acceptance due to negative perception of such projects, that people often feel that these projects will cause pollution in our area, they'll destroy the environment in our area, which is not happening in a lot of developed countries, because they design their projects in such a manner that there's no or very little impact on the environment through their operations. Focus on material recovery. If you look at waste management hierarchy, the focus is on reduce waste reduction, reuse, waste reuse, and recycling. Whatever you can recycle, you should recycle. And then comes to waste to energy options. Whatever cannot be reused or whatever cannot be recycled should only go to the waste energy. So that is why, I mean, that's also in a way one barrier. And poor construction practices and workmanship in India. Because most of the time when waste to energy projects or any project on the environment side, when this is bidded out, the municipalities or corporations often look for lowest bid. And lowest bid sometimes doesn't give you such good quality when they kind of implement the project and operate the project. So that's how a lot of these projects get closed. So to address some of these barriers, there's a need to supplement municipal solid waste with other waste streams. Sometimes if the calorific value is low, or also to homogenize the municipal waste, solid waste, a lot of paper, plastic and biomass is mixed to homogenize the waste. ESCOs, which are energy service companies, also hesitate to finance and fund these projects because these have financial risk for investment because of their uneven track record on operations. So what I'll do is I'll move from there to one of the pilot demonstration studies which we got funded from Ministry of Environment and Forest for demonstrating the possibility of landfill gas recovery. And in this case, this was Okhla landfill, one of the landfill sites in Delhi. It's not a scientific landfill. It's an open dump, which was, I mean, used for dumping for 25-30 years, and it has now become a mountain. So in October 2012 around time, we undertook this study to look at if there is a possibility of recovering landfill gas as an energy source from these dumps before they are closed or managed. So why we were looking at that? Uncontrolled methane emission from MSW sites are potential source of greenhouse gas, because most of you would know methane is one of the potential greenhouse gas. And there are in countries, there were several studies done by international survey agencies, which have identified at least 10 large landfills in the country, which are emitting methane uncontrolled, and from where methane can be trapped for energy recovery. Such landfills, once they reach their capacities, once they are full, they have to be closed and redeveloped into alternative post-closure and land use. So effort, that is why, as I said earlier, in US, in China, in Brazil, their efforts to recover methane as a potential energy source. So this was some statistics at that point of time in the three landfills in Delhi. One was Okhla, which was our case study landfill, Ghazipur and Bhalaswa. Bhalaswa has two sub-landfills. And overall, around 7,000 tons of municipal solid waste was disposed in these landfills. And all the three landfills at that point of time also were filled. So, I mean, disposal is still happening in these landfills. They were full and they were due for closure. This is result of some of the studies carried out by national and international consultants prior to our study, which had shown how landfill gas recoveries can be done in terms of meter cube per hour from some of these landfills, and how much power can be produced for 10 years period. US EPA supported study by Rade, SCS engineers again from USA for the Okhla landfill, then UCPA along with Municipal Corporation of Delhi for Bhalasawa, then US EPA under their methane to market global methane initiative, that carried out such studies, and that clearly showed that there's a potential, and that is what we wanted to confirm during our study. So this is Google Earth view of the Okhla landfill, where we were where we had installed our landfill gas extraction plant, and this is the site. We needed a flat land, and this side of the landfill was flat. That is why we decided to put our landfill plant here. On the left hand side, you see this is a hospital. It's a ASI hospital very close to landfill, and this side is a DTC depot. You can see also two buses being parked there. So idea was also to look at what kind of land use is there in the vicinity of landfill, and if gas is generated, then are there any users for the gas there? So this hospital uses steam for hospital purposes. So they have furnace which uses furnace oil. So if some gas can be used, it can be used very well by these people. If the gas can be further purified, it can also be used as a compressed landfill gas as an alternate transport fuel for transportation depot. So this was a pilot which we had installed. There's a pipe, a PVC pipe on the right-hand side, you see. All the gas extracted comes to this point, and here it goes through scrubber system to remove the H2S, because landfill gas also, like a biogas, sometimes also contains hydrogen sulfide. So that has to be removed. Then it also has a moisture, because it's coming from ground in the moist condition. So it has to be passed through chiller to condense the moisture. And then purified gas goes through the stack, where it is burnt at the top. When the gas starts coming in, it is ignited and it shows the flare coming out. So that shows that the gas is coming out. These are the layout of the wells which were dug in the three directions on the landfill. And these wells all were interconnected, and they were also connected to the common collection point going to the landfill gas flaring system. Another photograph of gas well. And important to note here is all the materials which are used are essentially PVC and PVC material, because what happens is landfill gas, since it has moisture and H2S, if you use MS steel pipe, then it eats away those pipes over the time. and you have to then reinstall those. We monitored this landfill gas for a year, and this is data for LFG modeling results. And what we realized is that this Okhla landfill is a big landfill. On an aggressive condition, if entire landfill is put into gas collection and entire landfill is generating gas, then around 5,400 meter cube of gas can be generated per hour. Under conservative conditions, if we cannot seal all the landfill and gas still leaks from other sources, then also you can generate around 2,700 meter cube per hour of gas. So that is interesting. And what are the economic benefits of this kind of gas recovery? If there's no gas usage at the site, I mean, if you cannot use it for traditionally waste to energy process, still it can be used for drying the leachate, which is generated from landfill. As a cooking fuel or fuel for the boiler, furnace or kilns in the neighborhood, as I said earlier. In cold countries, they also successfully use it for space heating. Power generation, if the grid for evacuation is available. And further purification, as I said earlier, and use as a transport fuels. What is the environmental benefit of landfill gas extraction? It prevents uncontrolled emission of greenhouse gas. No adverse health impacts on sanitary workers and waste workers working at the disposal site. And also, because when the landfill starts operating, after a few years, a lot of people also come and start residing close by. So there's no health impact on those that population as well. And as you know, methane is a dangerous gas. When it comes out in the air, many times it explodes. Also, in the subsurface, it has explosion hazard. So it also, if you harvest all the landfill gas, it reduces fire and explosion hazard. So with this, I'll close my presentation here, and I'll be happy to open it for discussions and question and answers. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. Now, I think if anybody has any questions, please ask. Sir is very much available to...
Or any clarification? Maybe.
Sir, I have a question, actually, sir.
Sure.
You just told that this pyrolysis and gasification is not the recommended solution of municipal solid waste. What is the reason about that, actually? Is it the poor conversion to combustible gases, or what is the exact reason for that?
So what is happening is pyrolysis is established process in a lot of, your feed material is single feed material. For example, waste tire, if you are using it as a raw material of feedstock, or if you are using single polymer plastic as a feedstock, then the oil which you produce as a product is uniform in quality. So if you enter into long-term buyback arrangement from industry or someone who is interested in using your oil as a fuel, he needs some guarantee that fuel, say, supplied for a year or 2 year or 3 year is of consistent quality. If you put your gasifier based on municipal solid waste, then the fuel quality changes when the waste quality changes. So that is a problem. And also, at this point of time, we are fortunate that diesel and gasoline prices are very high. So pyrolysis oil still can be sold at a good price. When the diesel and petroleum prices are low, then selling the pyrolysis oil becomes a problem.
Sir, what I was thinking that because this is the area where we can generate clean energy, because from waste. So I think if there is any scope, we can work on such topics, actually, because this is very important topic for today's research, because conversion of solid waste in the form of combustible gases, you know, it can directly be used in the kitchen as a clean energy.
Yes.
So that I'm thinking actually.
Yes. No, I agree.
Okay.
These are challenges.
Yes. Yes. Okay. Anybody else want to ask? Okay.
Namaskar Pandey sir. Sir, I'm Dr. Harsh Sharma, and it's not exactly queries actually. What I want to add to this is actually it was a presentation was absolutely fantastic, sir, and we were happy to be a part of this presentation. What I can see from the presentation, sir, the biggest hurdle is actually segregation of the waste. You know,
it is.
Getting homogenized waste. Because yes. Once we get it streamlined, then the adoption of technology, even the cost part also can be reduced significantly.
Yes.
So my thing is, I remember long back, there was a campaign from the government side to use two different color coding for segregation at kitchen itself, blue one and the green ones actually.
Yes.
I don't know what has happened actually, but I still understand that collecting the waste and segregating is always difficult compared to segregating to the sort itself and then to collect it. So that becomes much, much easier for all of us actually.
You're very right.
One part, sir. Apart from that, actually, I also feel, we are addressing this problem in a reverse direction. Say, for example, in a municipal, this Delhi or Bombay cities, where the problem has already accumulated in such a big way. Suppose this culture is started in small cities, which are, say, two-tier cities.
Yes.
Then possibly the people will be inculcated with the habit of segregating and dealing with the management waste.
Yes.
This municipality waste.
Yes.
So this is the only point, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Harsh. Thank you very much, sir, for a very informative and enlightening lecture. I hope that we all have been benefited a lot with this lecture. Now, as a tradition of our SIMFAR, actually we, sir, gave a memento in the form of a book. So we have here a book for you, sir. So this book I will send to you by post. So please accept it.
Sure.
And thank you again, sir. And now I request Dr. Harsh Verma to propose a vote of thanks. Dr. Harsh Verma, please. So.
Thank you, Dr. S.P. Singh. Good evening to all of you. Respected Dr. Pandey, our learner speaker of the day, Dr. Pradeep Singh, our beloved director, SISAR SIMFAR, my colleagues from SIMFAR headquarters and various research centers, our project staffs, various research scholars, they're connected online and offline mode both. And I have this proud, privileged duty to propose vote of thanks on this occasion. At the very onset, before I express my gratitude to different contributors, I also take this opportunity to congratulate all members of SIMFAR family for a dedicated 75 years of this journey through SIMFAR. Sir, I would like to first express our thankfulness to our learner speaker, Dr. Sunil Pandey, Director, Environment and Waste Management Division, TERI, for sparing time to deliver an insightful and extremely relevant lecture, and also for being part of this Platinum Jubilee celebration. The talk was enlightening, extremely relevant for our various ongoing research programs too. Sir, thank you very much. I also express thankfulness to our beloved director, Dr. Pradeep Singh, for the encouragement, supports, and guidance in organizing this Platinum Jubilee Lecture Series. Sir, you are our torchbearer, and on behalf of all our colleagues at SIMFAR Bilaspur, a very wholehearted big thank you to you for all support all through. We are also thankful to our HRD team, led by Dr. Kumkar, and then our scientists and technical staff from ITCL, my scientist colleague from Dhanbad headquarters, and our various centers. They have actually one way or other way given a lot of support in organizing the program. There are a series of lectures that is being organized as a part of this Platinum Jubilee celebration, sir. So I thank you, each one of them. I also express our thankfulness to the scientists and staff members of Bilaspur Center, in conducting this program, the contributions, organizing the things and events. Thank you, everyone. Thank you very much. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Harshvardhanji.
Now I request our director, sir, if available, to say a few words. Sir. Pandey sir, actually there is a parallel online lecture going on in our head office. So I think sir is busy in that lecture. So on behalf of my director, sir, I thank you very much. And I invite you to do visit our center, sir. We will have some joint programs. Sure. Maybe because I'm also the person of related to environment, actually. I did my PhD on environment from Nagpur University. Oh, wow. So I think if possible, we will do some joint research projects. I think Girija Madam, we are already discussing on that, actually. So thank you. Thank you very much, sir. And now... I get permission to stop the program here. So thank you everybody. Now we'll have a Pandey sir, do you want to say something?
Just to add, just now I got call from Dr. Ashok Kumar Singh, who is with your Dhanbad Center Coal Combustion Lab.
Yeah.
He is my old colleague from master days from BHU. So I was very happy to be connected with all of you. And thank you so much. Jab bhi mauka milega, physically also I would like to be with you all. Thank you for the session.
We will see you very soon at our Simpar Dhanbad. So thank you very much. Okay, sir.
Thank you, Shivaji.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.